Cannabis Common Sense, the show that tells the truth about marijuana and the politics behind its prohibition.
Edition of Cannabis Common Sense. We have a great show for you tonight. We have some interesting hemp news that we're going to start off the show with. We have some very picturesque shots from the THCF Medical Garden, little production from Sky High Video Productions. Tim Pate and John Cornett are here to impress you with their guitar musicianship. And we'll be taking your phone calls in just a little bit, so stay tuned. And we will be ready after we show you the infamous Dancing Cannabis League. First story tonight is from Israel. A compound in cannabis should be evaluated as a brain tumor treatment, according to a new study from Ramat Gan, Israel. The primary psychoactive agent in cannabis, THC, possesses anti-tumoral activity in glioblastoma multiforme, or GBM, cell lines. Those are brain tumors. And it should be evaluated in clinical trials as a treatment for brain cancer, according to preclinical data to be published in the journal Acta Oncologica. Investigators at Bar Ilan University in Israel report that the administration of THC significantly affects the viability of GBM cells. Glioblastoma multiforme, the most aggressive form of glioma, or brain cancer, strikes some 7,000 Americans annually and generally results in death within 1 to 2 years following diagnosis. The investigators of this study wrote and concluded, quote, THC is an essential mediator of cannabinoid anti-tumoral action. Administration of delta-9 THC to glioblastoma multiforme, or GBM, cell lines results in a significant decrease in cell viability. It suggested that delta-9 THC and other cannabinoids be implemented in future clinical evaluation as a therapeutic agent for brain tumors, end quote. In 2006, investigators at Complutense University in Spain reported that the intracranial administration of THC decreased recurrent GBM tumor growth in humans. Separate preclinical studies indicate that cannabinoids can inhibit the proliferation of various cancer cell lines, including breast carcinoma, prostate carcinoma, lung cancer, and lymphoma. The full text of this study, delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol inhibits cell cycle progression by downregulation of E2F1 in human glioblastoma multiforme cells, will appear in Acta Oncologica next month. When it comes to North America, we Americans and Canadians seem to be very likely to search for cannabis on the Internet. Internet users in the United States and Canada are the world's most frequent searchers for websites about cannabis, according to a report this week by Reuters Newswire. According to statistics provided by the popular internet search engine Google, Canadians and Americans are more likely than citizens of any other countries to perform internet searches using the keyword marijuana. Both Canadians and Americans report higher rates of cannabis use compared to almost all other nations on the planet. These millions of cannabis consumers desire fact-based, educational information about marijuana and marijuana law reform, and they're increasingly turning to the internet and away from the federal government and the mass media to obtain their information, as is shown by this recent release from Google, the search engine. Our last story tonight is from Sacramento, California. The gubernator, Arnold Schwarzenegger, governor of California, has vetoed a hemp pilot project. California Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger, a Republican, has vetoed bipartisan legislation that would have defined industrial hemp as an agricultural field crop and established statewide regulations governing its cultivation by authorized farmers. As approved by the legislature, Assembly Bill 684 would have instituted a pilot program permitting farmers to cultivate hemp in four California counties, Imperial, Kings, Mendocino, and Yolo counties. The farmers would have been required by law to submit random samples of their plants to an authorized laboratory to assure that their crop did not contain THC potencies greater than 0.3%. Good for nothing, very low THC hemp. Schwarzenegger stated in his veto message, quote, "Under federal law, all cannabis plants, regardless of variety or THC content, are simply considered to be marijuana, which is federally regulated controlled substance," end quote. That's not actually true, but, you know, doesn't have to be for Schwarzenegger to say it. He can lie like most politicians. He speculated that farmers who failed to obtain federal permits to grow hemp could face federal prosecution regardless of state law. It is the second year in a row that Governor Schwarzenegger has vetoed such legislation. Industrial hemp is currently grown commercially in Canada and the European Union for its fiber content. According to a 2005 Congressional Research Service report, the United States is the only developed country that fails to cultivate the plant as an economic crop. One of these days. All right, well, that's the end of our hemp news segment tonight. Now we go to a brief musical interlude. How are you doing over there, Tim?
Well, I got just one message for the governor.
What's that?
We'll be back.
Yeah, yeah, I like that.
Well, you know, it's harvest time right now.
And you don't say.
I do.
We have some wonderful harvest videos that we're going to be showing, and we have some wonderful harvest buds that we'll be showing, and we'll be back.
I figured we'd do a little harvest music tonight.
That sounds fun.
All right, we'll do it. John? Moon Dance. Why not?
Okay, well, as Tim gradually makes his way over here into the seat beside me, I'd like to remind you that this is a live show, and if you're watching on the night of the 19th of October, 2007, then you can call us and ask questions about ending adult marijuana prohibition, which is something we're very actively working on, restoring industrial hemp, something else that's near and dear to my heart, and helping medical marijuana patients, which is another one of my not just pastimes, but a full-time occupation, actually. But we enjoy it. Boy, we have a lot of big buds out here tonight. You know, we got so many different kinds. I'm almost confused by it.
I take my hat off to you.
We've got some nice ones.
Look at that.
We've got, I think this is cheese.
Let me see.
Cheesy.
Now, I have to say that I tried cheese.
You tried cheese?
At the Cannabis Cup over in Amsterdam. that was one of the winners this last year.
Oh, I mean, well, imagine that.
There was a variety of cheese that was exceptional.
I think that's what we've got here is cheese.
Ooh.
And here we have our favorite candy man, Gary's Pakalolo. This is just a little tiny side branch.
Sure.
Of his
Pakalolo. Isn't that a Hawaiian variety?
That is. It's definitely a Hawaiian name. I'm not absolutely certain about its origin, but it's certainly a Hawaiian name.
Oh, it is a Four shame cannabis. We don't have smell-o-vision tonight.
Yeah, it certainly is. Let's see. Now, this one is Crippled Rhino. We're going to have to trim this off as the show goes on.
Yep.
Yeah, it's a big old top that is just about ready. Our patients are eagerly about to share in the wealth and bounty of the harvest, and hopefully in future shows we'll have some of that as well. And this one.
Good for them.
This is White Widow.
Nice.
Bud of White Widow. That's actually, these are the two strains we had the most of, the Crippled Rhino and the White Widow.
So White Widow has been a variety for a long time that's been very medicinally favorable to patients. Uh-huh. I don't know how else to say that, but
that's a good way to say it.
Yeah, it has worked very well for a lot of folks.
Yeah, and so we've got the White Widow, and then this is a Crippled Rhino Kush Cross, and this bud is just huge. It's huge.
I mean, in Kush Cross, like that's an Afghani strain, isn't it?
Off, yeah.
The Kush.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's definitely has some Afghani properties, and it certainly has a very skunky Afghani smell. Well, I'll just have lots of fun trimming this up for the rest of the show, which is another one of my favorite activities.
Yes, it does.
If you're out there and you're watching us tonight, then you can call us at 503-288-4448. That's 503-288-4448. And we'll be taking your calls right up to the top of the hour. So call us with interesting questions. You know, we did get the ballot title this week on the Oregon Cannabis Tax Act petition for 2010.
Good.
It's also been filed by some associates for 2008. However, the odds of us running it for 2008 are very small unless, you know, $500,000 drops from heaven somehow. Seems very unlikely.
It does seem unlikely.
But you never know. But we're really going to work on getting it going next summer for 2010. And the Oregon Cannabis Tax Act would end adult marijuana prohibition and legalize anyone could grow their own without a license. If you wanted to sell it, well, then you'd have to get a license and sell it through the state liquor store system. We actually designed that model based on the single convention treaty. We basically took the system of controls mandated by international treaty and implemented them in the Oregon Cannabis Tax Act. It's in the single convention treaty. It outlines
something
how
that we actually signed that we should be living up to a long time ago.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
and
that
so,
makes sense.
Yep, it was initially passed in 1961.
That's right.
And so there have been several other United Nations treaties on psychotropic substances that have affected it. But we implement that system of controls in the hope that and eventually when this comes to federal court, which if we pass it, it probably will go to a federal court, and the international treaties carry the same weight as the United States Constitution does in federal court proceedings. So by complying with the international treaties and the Constitution, we hope to exceed the purview of mere federal legislation and be upheld in the inevitable federal court challenge it would face.
Go above that.
After passage. It also would legalize unregulated industrial hemp, and it would let patients, anybody grow their own, but patients would be able to get their cannabis through pharmacies at cost. It wouldn't cost them, they wouldn't have to pay a tax on it.
Or somebody who's very sick. And probably doesn't have much income. That makes so much sense.
It does.
It does make sense.
Well, this Crippled Rhino top here is coming out here. It's a coming out party. So if you have a question for us tonight, you can call us at 503.
I've got something to say before we've got a caller, and before that we take the caller on, I want to congratulate Madeline Martinez. Because this last week at the National Normal Convention,
I was so happy to be sitting next to her.
She was awarded the Pauline Sabine Outstanding Female Leadership Award.
Yeah, National Normal recognized Madeline as Outstanding Female Leader in Cannabis Reform Policy.
Exactly.
I'm so proud she'd asked me to sit there beside her during that award ceremony. And I even think we might have her on the phone. Hello, Madeline.
Hey, you guys, thanks for mentioning that.
You're
Thank
welcome.
You so much.
Well, congratulations to you.
Yeah.
Well, it's a very humbling experience. Pauline Sabin, what a great woman.
Yeah. I understand that she led the reform back in the 20s.
Yeah, for ending alcohol prohibition.
Exactly.
So that's quite an honor, I have to say. It really is. And you have well deserved it, and you've earned it, and I expect bigger and better things out of you even yet.
Well, thank you.
And I'm so happy you're on as the chief petitioner on the Oregon Cannabis Tax Act. Thanks for joining in, and I know you're dedicated to cannabis legalization as much or more than anybody else out there.
Oh, you know I am. You know, I got a call from some reporters, and they were asking me about it, and I just told them, they said, well, why are you supporting this? And I said, because I have grandchildren, because I'd like to save our planet. Are those good enough reasons? You know,
I think so.
They did understand, because drug dealers don't ask for ID.
Sure. That is a fact.
Now, aren't you having a meeting tomorrow?
We are having a meeting tomorrow, and I wanted to let everyone know at Mount Tabor Theater tomorrow at 11 o'clock. The doors open, and we're expecting a big crowd, and we'd like everyone to remember that it's raining out there and bring the proper clothing, because you're going to be waiting for a little bit. But we need cutting, and of course we always take excess medicine, especially at this time of year.
Yeah, I wore my normal t-shirt tonight.
We're drying it as fast as we can.
I know it.
Now, I also heard that Keith Strope, who is the ex...
The founder of Normal.
Yeah, the founder of Normal.
He's Strop.
You're right. It does, yeah. He's met a few of those.
That's what he told me.
I understand that he has notified us that we are here in Portland, Oregon, the finest, strongest, most active group of normal people in the world. Is that not correct?
Yes, he did. He actually said in the world, and you know, we are in Japan as well. There's a normal over in Japan, but we are the strongest one.
Hey.
Yes, Oregon is now famous for that.
Yeah, it has a lot to do with his leadership, Madeline.
Oh, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. I appreciate it. You know, there's not too many, Hispanic women in charge of very much. But you know what? I'm proud to be the one here in Normal.
You're right.
Glad to have you here.
Yeah,
every
time I have her on stage, because I get a chance to run a few stages, I always say, now speak Spanish when you get up there, because I want everyone to know that we have people of Hispanic origin in our who can communicate in that language among us.
It's very
important.
Yes. I do love to speak Spanish, but some people consider it rude when you're in a mixed audience. And unfortunately, they kind of think you may be talking about them. So.
Hiding something.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, so I try to avoid it. I don't want to insult anyone.
I don't blame you. But
I speak it
so I understand. Well, I speak three or four words, and I understand the three or four words you use with me, so.
Well, thank you guys so much, and please, everybody come out to Mount Tabor tomorrow to support our community. We got a lot of calls today, and I also wanted to let you guys know that we're going to be adding another Saturday. We're going to be meeting again on a fourth Saturday starting in January.
We're
going to be introducing OMMP 101.
Very cool.
Good. So that's going to be on the... Currently, it's just on the second Saturday, except this month because of the National Normal Convention, right?
Correct.
But soon, in January, it's going to be the second and the fourth Saturday?
That's right.
That'll be good for the patients.
It will be.
I'm always very excited.
It will be.
Keep patients happy.
Yes. And I will see you all tomorrow at the meeting, huh?
Yes.
I'm sorry I won't be able to be there.
Are you going to be carving the world's largest pumpkin?
I am actually going to be attempting a Guinness World Record this weekend at Chinook Winds Casino in Lincoln City. I've had 10 hours of live television on NBC, CBS, ABC.
I've heard from several folks who saw you on all the different channels.
The National Public Radio interview today. It's been kind of crazy, but yes, I will be carving pumpkins this weekend. Giant, big,
monster
pumpkins.
Well, we will miss you, but we're very proud of you.
I'll miss you, too.
And will you take some pictures for us?
Okay, and you know what I want to do is get those giant pumpkin growers to teach our growers how to, you know, just... I have dreams. It's a dream.
The pumpkin cannabis cross. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
You know, the giant pumpkin this year weighed 1,685 pounds.
Wow.
I could see a 1,685 pound bug. Now that would take care of a lot of patients.
think the giant cannabis plant was in at about 15 pounds.
That's so big.
Wow.
That's a big plant. I've seen 5 pounds plants, and that was
I want to tell you guys also that tomorrow we're going to be signing letters to Peter Buckley, and Representative Peter Buckley and Diane Rosenbaum, because they were the ones that were courageous enough to kill that horrible legislation, that employee discrimination bill.
Right.
And we're all going to be signing letters to them tomorrow. At tomorrow's meeting.
Thank you.
Yeah, that was a helpful coalition.
Thanking them.
Yep.
All right. Well, thank you, gentlemen. Have a wonderful evening, and I'll see you tomorrow, Paul. And you
Sounds good.
A great, safe trip.
All right. Yeah. Thank you. I will.
Good night.
Thanks for getting in there, Madeline.
All right.
And congratulations.
Oh, yeah.
On the Pauline Sabin Award for the best woman activist in ending adult marijuana prohibition in the United States.
I think that's impressive and well-deserved.
Yeah. So if you're out there and you have a question for us tonight, here the 19th of October, 2007, and you can call us and ask or make a comment or something. If you could dial 503-288-4448. That's 503-288-4448. If you're not watching a live show, don't try to call that number. We do have another number you can call, though. If you want to get involved in the movement to end adult marijuana prohibition and restore industrial hemp and help the OCTA petition, then or you need help finding a doctor, we have a physician referral service that can help you get a medical marijuana permit. All of these flowers out here, it should be noted, are grown exclusively for medicinal patients' benefit and will be distributed exclusively to medicinal patients, people that hold a permit in the state of Oregon for medical marijuana. But if you want to call and get a referral to a doctor or get involved in the movement to end adult marijuana prohibition, you can call 503-235-4606. That's 503-235-4606. And I went to that National Normal Conference last week, and they
What'd
had
you
a.
Think?
It was fun. It was kind of like an old class reunion, you know, because I hadn't been to one in many years, and there were a lot of old friends there, people I hadn't seen in 10, 15, 20 years.
Oh, wow, good.
And so it was very neat, and I got to see a lot of different folks. I went up to the Dr. Bronner's booth. And they said they watched our TV show all the time back when it was on Pot TV, the internet website out of Canada. Anyway, they gave me a whole bunch of these little hemp soap bottles to show out here.
Oh, cool.
We have eucalyptus hemp soap, lots of eucalyptus hemp soap, peppermint hemp soap, almond hemp soap, hemp tea tree Castile soap.
Ooh.
And little soap bars. Here is a hemp rose pure Castile soap, rose and hemp.
Nice.
What more could you ask for that? And what is this? This is the Dr. Bronner and Sun Dogs Magic Orange Lavender Organic Balm for dry, chapped skin.
Oh, good stuff.
Or tattoos. And lip balm. A nifty Dr. Bronner and Sun Dogs Magic Peppermint Organic Hemp Lip Balm. Right there. All that neat stuff. Since we're in our show and tell phase, let's go to the bottles. This is probably the best preserved Lloyd's cannabis bottle that I've ever seen. It's got the label on the top. It's had some evaporation inside. It's got the full box with it. And so that is from about 1890. And this is a new piece de resistance. Maybe we can get a close-up on that a little bit later with get camera two to roll in. This is a 1870, one of the first American hemp bottles that I know of. It's it's an American hemp cannabis sativus, it says.
Uh-huh.
Fluid extract from William S. Merrill Chemical Company of Cincinnati.
Still around, aren't they?
I think they are. And it says, American hemp is an anodyne and nervine, but possesses little of the powerful narcotic, intoxicating, and hypnotic properties of the East India variety. It's recommended in rheumatism, hysteria, mental depression, etc. In gonorrhea and in affections of the bladder, it's said to be very efficacious. Used both internally and for injection, it says.
Injection?
I'm not injected.
I'm not either.
Hey, that's a much better.
I don't Jones that much.
No, so you can barely see it. We got to get a better contrast.
It
yeah.
is.
American hemp.
The label's got a lot of acid in it, so it's browning up. But
it's still got a lot of the actual fluid in there. See,
yeah, I do.
The cork's been broke off.
The other one doesn't look like it's ever been opened. Actually.
No, it hasn't. It's never been opened. It's just evaporated out over 120 years. That can happen.
It certainly can.
pretty nifty.
That is, actually. It was a nice addition to your collection.
Yeah, the Foundation's collection. Soon we'll have the museum. I think at the Oregon Medical Cannabis Awards, we'll probably have a number of these bottles on display there.
Oh, so that'd be nice.
There's another reason to come. Oh, yeah, we've got about 200 pieces now. And it's worth pretty penny. But we have a caller. Hello, caller. You're on the show.
Hi. How you doing?
Good.
Very well. How are you tonight?
I got a question to ask you.
Okay.
Oh, I know it's going to sound weird, but I can't seem to understand what's going on. I've been smoking marijuana for about 17, 18 years.
Uh-huh.
Oh, I had a back problem always, and I never could take the Vicodins or Percocets because they would mess me up completely.
Sure.
But now, this last several months, I can't smoke it anymore because I'm getting anxiety attacks, and I don't understand is when I stop, I'm okay, but when I try to smoke it at night for the pain, it seems like I've been getting like a panic attack, and I don't understand what's, you know, I don't get it. It doesn't make sense to me.
Are you smoking the same variety each time?
Oh, yeah, pretty much.
Change varieties.
My medical marijuana card.
Change variety.
Is that what it could be?
Well, yeah. Sometimes if it's harvested early, it can be really speedy. And the speedier it is, the more paranoia and anxiety you can get. And so if you've got an opportunity to use a different variety for a while, that might help you. But otherwise, go to your doctor and ask your doctor about it as well. And maybe you could also try eating it, other recipes, or maybe not smoking it, or trying it in a tincture or
vaporization too.
Or glycerin. Uh-huh. You know, there are other options too, so you might try some other options rather than, you might be getting too much all at once, by your method right now, so it's something you ought to think about.
I'm thinking maybe because I guess I came down with some sinus problems, I'm thinking maybe that's the case maybe.
Well,
I asked the doctor, but they don't even know.
Yeah, most doctors aren't really educated on cannabis at all, unless the different varieties or other things with it. So.
But really fast, they want to give you, pain pills or, Percocets. I mean, they want to push that on you instead of, and I don't like to take that stuff. I mean, mm-hmm. I really don't.
Well, taking cannabis orally will help control pain, spasms, seizures, and glaucoma even better than smoking. You can even take the leaf, stuff like this, just the leaf, not the flower. And take that orally, and that will, it's CBD in the cannabis, and CBD is found equally in the flowers and the leaf. Since the leaf's a lot cheaper, it makes sense to, if you need to control pain, spasm, seizures, or glaucoma, to take something made out of the leaf orally 3 times a day.
Really?
To help control that. And it won't give you the high associated with cannabis, so you won't have that anxiety, but it will give you that relaxation of your muscles, and it ends muscle spasms and seizures.
It'll be a lot of difference then.
Yeah, exactly.
Because now when I smoke it, it's like, it's like weird. I could.
And that's all been the same kind of cannabis that you've had that reaction to?
Yeah.
Then it makes sense, a lot of sense, that if you're going to smoke it, to try something else that doesn't give you that reaction, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks a lot, guys. I appreciate it.
You bet. Sure. Glad to try to help there. Good luck with that.
Bye.
Well, we've shown you these big buds here in this state, and these are just recently harvested. They're not even completely dry yet. But now, we're going to take you to the garden. Mini herbal wonders. I hope you enjoy it. So let's roll that tape.
Cool.
Welcome to the THCF Medical Gardens. And cannabis common sense, where we make good sense for you.
It would be so bomb. How many plants were there actually out here in the garden?
35, I think. Is that right? Yeah, 35.
Thank you. employment out there in Cannabis, Common Sense, and hemp.org.
And Paul, you're 6 plus feet, right?
Yes, I am.
I am. Yes, 6'1", actually.
Those plants were taller than you, too.
They were. They were.
That was the rhino. Which one of these was the rhino?
This is the crippled rhino.
Okay, there you go.
We had a good selection. We think that we're going to enter this in the Oregon Medical Cannabis Award, so you guys just get ready. That's all I can say.
Oh.
You know, we'll see what happens. We have another caller, though. Hello, caller. You're on the show.
Oh, thank you. Beautiful plants.
Thank you.
Anyhow, I had some questions concerning indoor growing and your homeowner's policies. Does bringing a indoor operation in, does that void your homeowner's policy?
No. No. In fact, I've known at least 25 people who've gotten a settlement for their stolen medicinal cannabis.
Oh, okay. So you just have to verify with your insurance carrier and...
If you've had a theft, then you have to make a claim and, you know, state a value for that cannabis or how much it will cost you to replace it.
Okay, now, when you are setting this up, do you have to bring in certified HVAC and electricians to...
It certainly helps. It certainly helps.
You don't want to burn your house down.
Oh, I agree. I agree. That's why I was kind of curious. I didn't know. Like I said, I'd had some concerns.
We would never give you advice to go other than the proper way.
Yeah.
Oh, I
recommend you go overcode. That's what I always did. Oh, yeah. Needs
okay.
a 5/8. Well, I think I'll use a 4/3 wire. You know, mm-hmm. something bigger than what's actually required.
You want to carry enough.
Better to have excess capacity rather than too little capacity.
All right, I appreciate your info.
Remember those little lights are very thirsty.
The big grow bulb in the sky does not need very much power bill.
That's
the thing I was thinking about. You know, I was just trying to imagine what it would have cost to grow this indoors, and I was thinking, you know, just the electricity would have been about $50,000 a month.
Yeah.
To flower this indoors.
That level, yeah, yes.
Yeah.
For that many patients.
Yeah, that's right.
All right, once again, I appreciate it.
You're welcome. Yeah, the power bill is a lot lower once you're using solar power.
Yes, it is.
Solar power. Now, I have been informed that I gave some misinformation.
Yeah, that's not cheese.
This bud on the end is not cheese. It's Big Bud, and it's grown indoors. All the rest of this was grown outdoors, but it was grown indoors.
There
this Pacololo plant, this is just a small little side branch off of it, but you saw the ladies down there trimming the leaves off this one. This one was pre-trimmed while it was a small plant.
Yeah.
You get a big tree, and it's very difficult to sit there and trim a big tree.
It takes more than one hand.
A lot more work, anyway. You know. So. Now, if you're out there and you have a question for us tonight, you can call us at 503-288-4448. That's 503-288-4448. And we'll be taking your calls for about another 20 minutes or so. Maybe not quite that long, because Tim's going to jump back over there with John Cornette and play another fantastic song.
We are later
not
on.
Yet.
Not yet.
Not yet.
Hold your horses.
We shall. Now, if you're out there and you have one of the conditions that qualifies for medical marijuana, then we have doctors who can help you. You know, there are a lot of different conditions. There's chronic pain is the largest single condition. It qualifies for medical marijuana in all the states for which medical marijuana is legal. There's a dozen of them now. Also, chronic and severe nausea, no matter what its cause. If you have chronic and frequent nausea, that qualifies, as does AIDS, glaucoma, IBS, or irritable bowel syndrome. Seizure disorders like epilepsy and spastic disorders like multiple sclerosis, asthma, GERD, hepatitis C, Crohn's disease, and, of course, cancer patients all qualify for medical marijuana all across the western United States. So if you need help finding a doctor, we know dozens and dozens of doctors across the western United States that can help you. So just call us at, here in Portland, 503-235-4606. That's 503-235-4606. If you're up in Seattle, we do have a Seattle number up there, and that Seattle number is 206-878-1701. There it is, 206-878-1701. And if you are in Denver, and this show is, according to the folks there in Denver, the most popular cable access television show in Denver, and you can call us there at 303-403-9996. That's 303-403-9996. Now, if you are outside of the Portland, Seattle, or Denver metropolitan areas, then we have doctors who can help you in Washington State, Oregon, California, Colorado, Nevada, and Hawaii. Just call our toll-free number, 1-800-723-0188. That's 1-800-723-0188. And we can help you find a doctor. We can help you get that medical marijuana permit. Compassionate doctors are not rare in our offices. We have another caller. Hello, caller. You're on the show.
Hi, is that me?
It is. It's you. It's us, too.
Okay. Hey, what's the best strain that would work for pain? I've got nerve pain in the back from old compression fractures, some stenosis in the cervical vertebrae where it's the MRI shows where the spine is so narrow that it actually, the spinal cord appears to be touching up against the bone.
Have you got any neurological problems like pain in the legs or loss of continence or anything?
I get numbness and burning sensation in my hands and severe pain down through my neck and in through my back.
I'm just wondering
if I was going to do this, what would be the best strain to try and acquire as far as that would get you, like the previous caller called in with the...
Yeah, the anxiety.
What's that?
The fellow who had the problem with anxiety.
Well, yeah, I don't know if I would have a problem with that or not, but I just want to stay away from that aspect of it. But I've heard that indica kind of maybe would do that, where sativa maybe wouldn't. But I'm just wondering if
you know it's different in different people. Sativas generally grow very, very tall and have very narrow leaves and have a spicier flavor, kind of like the old Mexican that some of you may remember from the 60s. I know I do. But is
that the sativa?
Yep, that's the sativa. And you know, a lot of people think that is kind of a wake me up, kind of peppy high. It might, you know, have some tendency toward anxiety if you're prone to that. Indica is more of a sleepy experience in general, but then you can take the very same plant and harvest it at different times and have a completely different reaction and different kind of medicine. If you harvest it early, when the dry chromes, the little crystals that form on the flowers, are clear as glass, you're going to get kind of a less sleepy, more awake narcotic. That's why Tim had said if you'd had some early harvested flowers, that might tend to or be more likely to cause anxiety. Mm-hmm. Where the same flowers, if you waited till the crystals turn an amber or a little opaque, or you can wait till they turn very dark, yellow, reds, and browns, and blacks even, then the same plant could have a different effect. However, if you take cannabis orally and you use the leaves as opposed to the flowers, you're not going to get the psychoactive effect of cannabis using the leaves. What you're going to do is get a big dose of CBD, and it's the CBD in cannabis that helps for pain, spasm, seizures, and glaucoma. So if you have any of those conditions, you want to take cannabis orally. That's going to be the most effective way to do it. You can put it into an alcohol-based tincture or a glycerin-based tincture, or you could cook it at a very low heat for about an hour in oil or butter, then strain off the vegetative matter and use what's left for cooking with your, you know, the oil or butter in any other recipe.
Eating the leaves raw wouldn't do it any good then. I'd have to kind of heat it up to get the CBD out of it then.
Exactly. There's a process, it's called decarboxylation. It strips the carbon dioxide molecule off the other cannabinoids, and that activates it and makes it medicinally active. So once that carbon dioxide molecule has been stripped off, and that's generally happens when it's cooked at a low temperature, either in vaporization or cooked in an oil or butter, or the alcohol will cause decarboxylation to take place as well in making a tincture. Then that medicinally activates it and makes it work a lot better.
If a person was to cook it in some kind of oil or butter, what would be the prime temperature, the optimum temperature to cook it at?
About 225, and you'd want to cook it for about an hour and grind it up before you put it in there and stir it frequently. And then after about an hour, strain off all the vegetative matter because all the active ingredients are now in the green oil or green butter. Yeah. And then just a teaspoon of that would help with pain. Or if that's not enough, maybe a tablespoon. And for glaucoma patients, I've heard patients that just take 4 or 5 drops a day that's had dramatic effects on lowering intraocular pressure and thus treating glaucoma.
Well, I remember a couple of years ago you had Dr. Orval, it was about a year and a half ago, Dr. Orval was on there and he was talking about his little escapade where he had the finger in the eye and he had some kind of glaucoma problem.
Exactly.
And it worked pretty well.
And he found just a little bit of tincture, amazed his ophthalmologist. He didn't tell the ophthalmologist, though. But we're right. thinking that next in December, Dr. Orvald will be on the show a lot more frequently. So we're
oh,
looking
cool.
forward to that.
One other question I had for you. As far as the presidential candidates, I know Richardson is on the Democratic side, is one of the people that's pro-cannabis. Is Kucinich, too?
You know, Kucinich has actually been on this show twice back in 2004 when he was running for president then. So he is a supporter of ending adult marijuana prohibition and restoring industrial hemp and helping medical marijuana patients. So Kucinich, I would say, is our best bet out there. And when it comes to the other Democrats, most of them are worlds better than all but one Republican. There's one Republican, Ron Paul,
okay,
who's also in favor of industrial hemp and ending adult marijuana prohibition. He's a libertarian activist and therefore advocates a lot of libertarian principles, which includes ending drug prohibition.
I saw him for about 5 or 10 minutes, the last 5 or 10 minutes of his broadcast on C-SPAN 2 about a week ago, and he actually did seem like he was a common sense, lucid, not a typical politician.
Yeah,
that's,
he's a doctor. He's an MD.
Which means he probably won't get elected.
Well, you never know.
But, you know, it sounds like a very good candidate.
I have personally supported Kucinich and given some money personally to his
cool.
campaign and have some bumper stickers and a sign in the front of our office. He's the only candidate that's come on this show.
Well, he's getting back.
I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah.
We'll have to run
so Richardson would be just kind of maybe talking about him and not doing too much, huh?
Yeah. Well, you know, Richardson, he definitely did a lot to push medical marijuana through the state legislature in New Mexico, and he's been very vocal in supporting medical marijuana patients. So we've got to appreciate that. Just about all of the, or every single one of the Democratic candidates have said they were for ending the raids on California dispensaries and stopping federal prosecution of medical marijuana patients. So
this is a waste of our taxpayers' money when they're doing that, because they should be going after the stinking tweakers, the methamphetamine labs, the super labs that I understand are in Mexico, and the ones that are around here. I guess they've busted quite a few of the ones in the United States, and they're not getting quite as many
sure.
bucks anymore.
They could. There's a lot of different places they could focus their resources on. I heard Howard Wooldridge, who's a member of Law Enforcement Against Prohibition, and on their board of directors, saying just he wanted to see the money go into enforcing drunk driving laws, because we have 35,000 people a year that die from at the hands of drunk drivers, while less than 2,000 people a year die from all illegal drugs combined. And also go after the people who are running stop signs and killing people there, you know.
Yeah.
How many? It's well over 200,000 people a year die in automobile accidents.
Yeah.
So,
and then there's also people nowadays being burglarized at home during the day while they're at home.
Yeah.
This just happened in my neighborhood here the other day, and I thought I lived in a fairly safe neighborhood, but I guess not. But they came right in through the house there, and I can't remember if it was the big dog scared them off or something. But
well, thank goodness for that. Something scared them off.
But that's probably more than likely one of these meth users, these stinking tweakers, and I just I think they really need to, if they're going to be using our tax money, they need to use our tax money to go after dangerous people,
yeah.
Not people that are laid back, taking it easy, not bothering anybody else. And
yeah,
I think
I agree with that wholeheartedly.
I'd like to see all the people out there listening tonight. Get on the horn and start calling their congresspeople and their senators and other elected officials and say, hey, quit wasting our money on these, raiding these cannabis people, and go after the dangerous drugs like methamphetamine, which is, it's ruining people's lives financially, because these people get in and get a hold of their financial information and they're ruined for years.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's very difficult to repair your credit once it's been ruined.
And these people are also dangerous and psychotic. You know, it's just absurd that they're wasting money on this busting people for just using, you know, growing weed.
It's a lot safer. It's a lot easier to go after peaceful marijuana growers than to deal with crazed, sleepless tweakers on crank.
We're wasting our money in this country.
Well, I, for one, are mad as hell. I'm not going to take it anymore.
So. Good. I urge you to do just what you said and contact your legislators. A little handwritten page. You don't have to write multiple pages. One short two- or three-paragraph letter is written by hand to your state representatives, state senators, and your U.S. representatives and U.S. senators will go a long way. And you send out one of those every month or so, and you'll have a huge impact.
Oh, by the way, I want to say one thing to the caller that called in earlier about the he had problems with the anxiety and whatnot, that he also had a problem with some kind of sinus infection or whatever, and that could be also related to his bronchial, to his breathing passages there. But if he would vaporize, I want to maybe start the slogan out, be wise, vaporize. Maybe you guys could put that.
Yeah, I like that.
Maybe put that on your banner underneath your Cannabis Common Sense there on your desk. But I think a lot of the only negative portion, I believe, of using cannabis is the smoking part of it. If people would vaporize or use other some form of ingestion, I think any of the negative problems with cannabis would probably go away, especially all those people with the sinus problems. They wouldn't have them any longer. So, anyway, sir, that's all. I get off my soapbox, let you guys get back.
All right. Well, thanks for your call. Appreciate your input. Thanks. Well, we're out here, and we've got about 5 or 6 minutes left, so I might be able to field another call before Tim and John Cornette get their guitars all ready to go with another song. So I just want to remind you, the number there is 503-288-4448. That's 503-288-4448. And, I want to give you a little update on the coming shows. We've got one more live show we're going to do before we're going to run a series of tape shows through the month of November. We've got 4 tape shows that will be running during the month of November, footage from a lot of different things, everything from how not to get busted and entertainment from lawyers to excerpts from the National Normal Conference and videos from the ACLU, more excerpts from the THCF Medicinal Gardens. But this will be is our next to the last live show until the end of November. We'll be back with our regular live shows at the end of November and on through the end of the year as we get ready for the holiday season. So I want to also remind you that if you or a loved one need medical marijuana, then we have doctors who can help you. Whether you have chronic pain, which is the largest single category of patients who have medical marijuana, like the degenerative disc disease in the back that gentleman was talking about, or you have seizures, spasms, glaucoma, GERD, which is a gastrointestinal reflux disease, hepatitis C, Crohn's disease, IBS, anything that causes chronic nausea, or you have AIDS, cancer, glaucoma, then we can help you. We have doctors in Portland. If you need help, call us at 503-235-4606. That's 503-235-4606. We're also gearing up with our petition campaign for next summer to end adult marijuana prohibition, and you can call us at that number to organize in the Oregon campaign at 503-235-4606. If you need the doctor referral up in the Seattle area, then we have this number. It's 206-878-1701. That's 206-878-1701. If you are in Denver, then you can call our office there in suburban Denver at 303-403-9996. That's 303-403-9996. And if you're outside of Portland, Denver, or Seattle, but still in the western United States, we have doctors in Washington State, Oregon, California, Nevada, Colorado, and Hawaii. We're ready to help you get a medical marijuana permit as long as you have one of those qualifying conditions. You can call our toll-free number at 1-800-723-0188. So I want to thank you for watching Cannabis Common Sense again. And tune in next week. And remember to help us restore hemp. And I think you're ready to go, Tim. All right, might as well launch in there.
All right.
Thank you, gentlemen.